Hello, everyone. So for today, I will warm up you before Nick. So let's talk about machine learning in Ruby. So this is little information about me. Web and mobile developer, DevOps, have some open source libraries, some open source books, it's possible, and leading a report podcast about Ruby and JavaScript. So let's begin with machine learning. So what is machine learning? It's ability to computer provide some data, and it can do some conditions or explicit stuff by this data. So it's similar to data mining, but if data mining to extract some data and do something, machine learning is to reflect by patterns by this data and do something by these patterns. So first of all, probably you don't need machine learning. Let me provide for you a little example. We developed for us game client and said like, hey, need very interesting application. This application should synchronize any online banking account and get from this banking account transactions and categorize automatically these transactions. Like if it's fuel, it's spending for cars, if it's food, it's categories for food and everything else. And we decided machine learning is very good for this. Like, let's use machine learning, it will be cool. But of course, this application was developed from scratch. Like, just came client and said, I have idea, let's build it. We have our manager and sent him to create several accounts in several banks and became spending from these cards randomly. After several months, we have application which predict his transaction in 99%. So if he synchronizes each day his transaction, it automatically provides information like, oh, this is food, this is gym, this is everything else, like, perfect. No category others. Like, others, it means found anything. And we were so happy about this magic about machine learning, so we decided to make demo for client. We make demo. Client synchronize own accounts with spending and system provide for him others for every transactions. Not can categorize anything. This is our where we understand that data is the major problem for machine learning. If you don't have data, you can forget about machine learning. Data is the main point for it. It's magic stuff doesn't work without data. For our case, it was perfect only for one person. It learned from one person and understand perfectly one person. But of course, if came another person, it doesn't know anything about these transactions. This is the main idea, main problem. If you don't have data, you cannot build good machine learning stuff. Second, it's you should have good data management. Sometimes came client and said like, we need machine learning. It will be cool. We said, okay. Show me your data management. They said, we store something in this database, something in these files already. They said, no, it's data storage, it's not data management. Because if you have database and mostly it's used for your application, it's not built in for marketing or something else. So if you need machine learning, you should build system which will manage your data, collect, aggregate, and clean up it for machine learning. Without this, again, machine learning is very hard to do. Because when we begin building transactions system, which categorize transactions, first of all, we build system which normalize and clean up transactions. Because some numbers, some points, some sums are not very important for machine learning stuff and don't provide any good information for this. So this is, first of all, what you should know about machine learning. No data, sorry, no machine learning. So what types of areas machine learning we have? We have supervised learning. I think everyone who first tried to teach or do something with machine learning, he became with supervised learning. Supervised learning is like, I provide some information to algorithm, like this, for example, my example with transactions. I provide like this transaction, it's food. This transaction, it's fuel. After this, I can ask algorithm like, okay, what do you think? what about this transaction? And it can predict by this learning, like, oh, I think it's spending for something else, or something like this. This is called supervised learning. So first you teach it, and after this you can ask it. Next one is unsupervised learning. So you don't teach anything this algorithm. You only, for example, provide some items with some attributes, and then ask, can you find some clusters about these items, or maybe some categories? So you can you find some patterns, and can I use these patterns later? In this case, use unsupervised learning. Reinforcement learning, it's something like this game Mario. Like, you have Mario, you have environment, and the main goal of Mario to save princess. So Mario have actions, jump, down, left, right, something like this. And by these actions, the main idea of Mario to achieve goals to save princess. And this algorithm understand, like, if Mario push some enemies, it will die and remove one line. So it's not good. And algorithm begin learning by these actions, like this bad and this one action will provide for me rewards. And it will go into these next actions. The same reinforce your learning used, for example, self-driving cars. Because environment is dynamically, it's not static. And it should decide what to do. For example, going from point A to point B, it's the main goal. And of course, not kill person until it's driving there. So this is what we have right now. So practical machine learning problems. First one is spam fraud detection. I think everyone knows, for example, Spam Assassin utility, which use basic categorization for spam detection. So it's supervised learning, like you teach it, like this is spam email and this one not, and it automatically classify all this stuff. Fraud detection is also very important. If, for example, you have big billing system and you need, and of course you will have huge amount of fraud transactions. Machine learning can provide you information how to detect patterns of fraud transactions and reject them. Digit recognition, it's actively used by Google cars, which make images for Google Maps. So they recognize digits on buildings, like these numbers, and use this to build better cards, maps. And of course, this stuff right now is so cool. Right now, it 90% can break any captcha with digits because they learn too many numbers. Speech understanding face detection, I think no need to explain what is this. Product recommendation is very important because how use Amazon. Amazon see like this person buy with this product, this one and another one. And after some categorization of this stuff, it decide like, okay, for next customer, if I will provide the same number of products which both and other customers, very big chance it will he or she will buy it too. Medical diagnosis, yes, very important to found on early stage, for example, cancer in your body. And this is very good stuff to using in medical diagnosis. Customer segmentation to find hidden patterns or hidden group of your customers. And where you'd be surprised, like, whoa, my product used also this number of customer. Maybe we should move our business model to them too. And autonomous vehicles, self-driving cars. Okay, so stop talking about all this stuff. Let's begin with Ruby. Because Ruby, first stuff which very important is classifier reborn. It's some gem which have inside Bayesian classifier and latent semantic indexer, LSI. So this is my example, one of which we used. It's to classify, it's supervised learning. So you classify some stuff, for example, images, like these images with cats, these images, these dogs. And after some learning, you can just upload image and asking cat or dog, and it will provide human. Of course not. It will not do this because it only knows cats and dogs. So it will show some percentage, like I think 59% is cats. So this is how it works. you just create classifier, provide categories, interesting, uninteresting, and begin training. As you can see, you can train it. Like this interesting category, this example of training, uninteresting, this one. And after this, you can call classify this one, and it will provide you information. Like, I hate bad words, uninteresting, and everything else. This one is bias classifier. It's very simple classifier, small memory footprint, very good speed performance, but of course it's not so flexible. For example, I can create, like, I like movies with Bruce Willis and Sylvester Stallone, but I cannot, in this case, create classifier to not show me films where Sylvester Stallone and Bruce Willis together. It's very hard to build by bias classifier such stuff. Next one is LSI. It's very similar. So again, you provide some information, some categories. Right now it's in symbols. You teach it. And after this, you can classify. It's like, OK, what about this information? It's what kind of categories? And it will provide you some kind of categories. Of course, it's very simple examples because not so much data. As I said, for machine learning, you should have a huge amount of data. Next one, very interesting stuff called decision tree. How it looks like. For example, this diagram, it's selected all passengers from Titanic by some categories, and who live and who die. So for example, I have sex, male, yes, no, if no, survived. The next one is age, if bigger than 9. Died, and this one is number of siblings or spouse on the same ship on Titanic, and also died or survived. So as you can see how it works, you provide some information with some attributes, and it creates from this decision tree. Like after this decision tree, you can just provide some, like, okay, I have some sex, age, and number of siblings. What we'll do in this case? And by this decision tree, it will say it died or survived. Algorithm works very simple. It's if you provide some number of items and information, it just will find where biggest splitting of this information, for example, male, and automatically, so for example, if you have smallest entropy in sex, like yes, no, it will automatically create a root and split both of these chunk of information and continue again checking what attribute next have less entropy, again splitting to two branches with some roots. And in this case, you have this decision tree. One of the example of usage, I was building admin interface and some just customers fill some products by hand, like just typing by hand, and client decide can it, we speed up this stuff based like if client begin filling some characteristics to product, automatically prefill categories and everything else. So for this case, I decided to use decision tree, so it automatically learn, like if it can have screen, okay, and keyboard, in most cases, this is notebooks, or maybe this tablet with, and it begin decide what exactly category by all this stuff. So for Ruby exists such game, decision tree. This is like I train it, I have attribute temperature, and he provide temperature and state. Of course, 40 and 50 is dead, I think, even not really sick. It's already dead, but still. And of course, I begin training. So I provide attributes, training, continuous, and train this. And then I provide just this array. From this array, just interesting this one number. And it provides for me decision, like sick. And of course, it's the same as I expected. Next one, k-nearest neighbors. It's another classifier and supervised. It's mostly used for example, you have some number of groups and you point some, for example, you have map and you have stores, number of stores on this map. And if you point in some point on this map and you're asking, okay, closest store, for this one. It's not similar like geocoding or GeoAP. It's meant to add this point to some class of groups. And by this, it finds a closest nearby stuff like this one. So for this exists, of course, GEM, KNA. This is how it works. For example, I fill this by some arrays, and inside this array, four random numbers from 0 to 1. And after this, I ask in about provide for me nearest neighbors to this point, and of course, only two. And it provides for me index inside this array, distance, and this point in the same way. This is how it works. So for distance, we can use inside this gem used special gem called distance measures. It's special gem which used to how to calculate between some stuff distance measurement, because by default it uses Euclidean distance, but also you can use cosine similarity, Jacquard distance, or anything else. Because, for example, you're working not on square, but something else. Similarity. For example, you need to work with documents and need to understand how similar these documents. So you provide for this algorithm, like, this document's about food, this document's about animals. What can you say about this document? And it can provide, I think it's about animals. So this, you can use term frequency inverse document frequency stuff. Also exists library for this. You create some documents, fill it, and begin providing similarity. So as you can see, if I compare the same document, it provides for me one, like it's the same document, similarity 100%. In this case, it's a little less. Also, you can see like it can create you similarity matrix. So I have three documents, and it creates for me a similarity matrix. As you can see, this diagonal is one, because we compare the same document. And this one points also will be the same. Because if you compare A with B, it will be the same compare B with A. This is how it works. So next one, previous algorithm was supervised learning. So you first train algorithm, and after this, you're asking about classification and everything else. K-means, it's unsupervised learning. You just provide some information to it and asking about, show me please these groups. The main maybe disadvantage, you should provide number of these groups. So you provide some data and asking about, I think here should be two groups. Please show me them. And in this case, this algorithm will try to create and show these groups, like separate them. Like exist such games like k-means cluster and k-means just. How it works? Algorithm works very simple. For example, I have this amount of data and said like here should be three groups. It randomly select three center of these groups and split these groups. After first run, it begin moving closely center to these groups, each one. So how it works? It's begin moving to the center of these groups, these points, and again begin splitting. And as many runs you have, as more precisely will be these groups. This is how it works, for example. We have K-means cluster. This is coordinates with cities, New York, Los Angeles, Baltimore. And I said, like, here should be two cluster. And create K-measure cluster, add labels, and set like five runs, and show me these clusters. After this, it's provide for me like, yes, I created. We have Baltimore, Washington, DC, and New York cluster, and Las Vegas, Los Angeles, and Portland cluster. And after this, for example, I can ask like, okay, predict me where will be Chicago. And it said like, in first cluster, Baltimore, Washington, DC, and New York. This is another gem, K-means just. You can provide some, for example, again, data, some arrays. As you can see, it even see like this one cluster and this one. I said like here should be two clusters, and it just provide for me indexes of each one in clusters. So if also I can use distance measure gem again here and provide different measurement of distance for these clusters. Next one is artificial neural network. So, for example, we already see something from this It's, for example, K nearest neighbors. It was also neural network, just already predefined. So you just use it. Neural network, as you can see, is most simple, I think, explanation which I found about this stuff. So it's simple numbers, interconnected element and process, which have information and dynamic state response to external inputs. So you have a huge amount of this small stuff, and they interconnect and work together. This is how it looks like. I think many of you maybe see this image. Nothing understandable, of course, but it works. For this exist four Ruby gems, like RubyFan, TeLearnRuby, Cerebrum, NeuralNet. I don't know what is best. I only use Cerebrum. This is an example from it. Cerebrum, you just create network, begin training, like this is your input, this is output. And as you can see, even if I will provide the same stuff, and maybe someone will expect this one output, it will, no. 0, not 93, because it's not conditioned if, it's learning and trying to predict what value will be next. So if you need to know how many Ruby gems exist for machine learning, I have several links, because it exists a huge amount of gems. And I cannot, for example, describe everyone on this talk. But for Ruby, it's very big. I just not expected, for example, because I was thinking, OK, exist classifier, maybe some chi-means, and that's all. But when begin searching information and what we have, it's really impressive. So I'm not sure why someone will say, like, Ruby not ready for machine learning on or natural language processing. Also very interesting stuff. For example, I think who begin learning machine learning or computer vision or anything else know about this library, OpenCV. So OpenCV, it's very powerful library with huge amount of API. And for this exists Ruby OpenCV gem with bindings. So you can just use it, and it will have bindings for all this stuff. Also exists Apache Mahout. It's also Java library to build scalable performant machine learning application with some API inside. No MRI version of gem, of course. But if you use JRuby, in this case, machine learning even simpler for you. But still, you can use, for example, JRuby Mahout gem. This all stuff very good until you don't have so huge amount of information, which even doesn't fit in memory on one machine. Because for today, for example, if you have terabytes of data and you need to make machine learning on these terabytes of data, one application will not make this good, because in most cases, all this algorithm, they get all this information into memory, do some calculation, and make some decision on it. And as you understand, as more you have data, as more it's impossible to do on one machine. So you need clustering. In these cases, I think not even Ruby, not Java cannot do this alone. You need some better solution. One of them called Apache Prediction IO. It's open source machine learning server. So it's use HBase inside, some database like Postgres, MySQL, or HBase, and Spark. Spark used for computational stuff. And all this stuff, you just create cluster from this machine. So it's mostly designed used not on one machine, but on cluster of machines. You unpack it and provide some data, like from website, email campaign, mobile application. You just send all information here, set up all needed machine learning stuff for it. It have inside predefined algorithm for recommendation systems, for categorization, and everything else. And it have endpoints outputs for all this information. So you just query via REST API, like, OK, show me about this information category, or give me a recommendation for this product, and it will give you predicted results. So if anyone also like microservices stuff, this is a good idea to move machine learning into separate service. Next one growing right now is TensorFlow. It's stuff built by Google. It's also designed to work on cluster of machine, built on C. And right now you can just create number of this computational stuff on your cluster, and also through here information and get some outputs. Of course, exists TensorFlow gem, TensorFlow-RB, because by default it have only Java and Python SDK. But TensorFlow Gem is not very simple to install. It's not just get Gem install this one, because you need get TensorFlow, pre-build shared library to it, then link this shared library to TensorFlow Gem, and then pre-build this gem. And TensorFlow not so fast to pre-build. You should have very good machine with huge amount of memory, because it uses Java for pre-building, and it's not so fast. Of course, exists Playground. So as you can see, this is TensorFlow Playground. This is neural network. As I said, this is, for example, you have some information data, and you need to find two clusters, like blue and this orange. And if I will run this stuff, it automatically will clusterize me to these two stuff. For example, as you can see. Also, you can add some neurons additionally. This will try to improve all these calculations. And as you can see, we can provide some different examples. For example, find cluster here. Or you even can create some insane stuff. It's very hard to machine learning find here cluster, but it will try to do the best. So you just run, as I said, as many runs you have, and more precisely try to create these clusters. So here, for example, we need maybe add some additional layers, neurons, and in this case, it will be much better to build this stuff. Yes. So, and it will try to categorize all this stuff. As you can see, it tried to find these categories. Yes, as you can see, it has some training data loss. You can see how it's working, how it's tried to build all this stuff. As I said, it's a very complex example for it, because it's not just some local stuff. But as you can see, it's, yes, it built these two clusters for information. Yes, so this is solutions, what we have right now. So in conclusion, data management should be the first step before diving into machine learning. If you don't have data or don't have data management, only data storage, it's not possible to create good machine learning. It will be just playing with machine learning, but not real. Ruby is not considered bad for machine learning, because sometimes I see information like, no, Ruby is bad for machine learning, but mostly as I saw some libraries on Python, and for Ruby, it's also not so hard to create this library. And of course, better to make machine learning system a separate service or cluster if you have very big amount of data, because in this, because the system can grow so much, so any language cannot handle this on one machine. You need cluster, you need computational ability to do all this job, for example, in not big amount of time. And in this case, you can use some this stuff like TensorFlow, Prediction.io, to build own server, and for example, add to it Ruby with some pre-computational power. That's all, guys. Thank you. I think if it will move also to C, some of this computation, it will be much faster. But in most cases, as I saw, if you need exactly such type of computational, someone just use Rust or Go to make it faster there, and even doesn't use Python or Ruby. We like split this into separate service. Because even on Python, it can be slower and harder to manage memory. Because sometimes I saw problems like this library can memory can grow and not go again, and for you simpler to use some very small tiny library. Also, as I saw, not huge amount, like exists this SciRuby, but not huge amount of contribution into it, because not big amount I think right now needed this one, right now. But maybe later it will be bigger amount of persons. That's why I show this right now. Maybe we'll have more contribution to this library.
Right, any other questions? Anyone? Could you please elaborate a little bit about difference between data storage and management? Does it mean like with SQL we can manage our data, or maybe we need to have some additional application or whatever?
No. It's mostly mean like, as I said, you have application. It's application have some, for example, Rails application. It have some structure of database. And it mostly designed to work for this application. And then came guys and said, we have this data, let's use this for machine learning. But this not designed for machine learning and your steps. Like go marketing guys, for example, I maybe someone feel this and said, okay, let's use the same schema for marketing, but we need to improve this little. And it begin making some changes which not important for your application. So data management mean like your data should be specially designed and stored for machine learning, for marketing, and everything else. So it should be clean up from garbage, as I said, normalization of this data. It should be aggregate this data. If it's huge amount of data, maybe you need aggregation by days, by months, and anything else. But in most cases, if came client and said, we have terabytes of data here. We said, okay, how many important data stored here? They said, I don't know, let's try to check. And when we begin some pre-aggregation of this data, maybe several megabytes of data were important after this several terabytes of data. Because, so they, instead of doing this and save some storage, because they can, for example, each day pre-aggregate this data and store already prepared and good data, then just store everything and just expect that machine learning will use everything else from this. So this is very important, because if you just store something, it's not useful. I see many developers which just have huge terabytes of data and once a month go into this data, asking some like, give me this information and go away. And this is only, for example, counters or something like this. And go away. And this information doesn't provide anything more important. Because sometimes also came product, it has some data, but after researching, we found that this data not so important, but important data not collected all this time. Like it have, but they just forgot about this. Or in some, we just found it's not stored. Like they just expected it was stored, like in GitLab. But they go into no, nothing. But when they expected this. So this is the same.
I'm not a big specialist in machine learning, yeah.
Me
but
too.
It looks cool. I know that machine learning uses greatly MapReduce algorithms, yeah?
If you have cluster, in this case, your algorithm will be split into some stuff. And MapReduce, it's just pattern how to get from all this big amount of data some needed output or information. Map mean on each cluster you map something. And reduce, it will get all this mapping and do some reducing on the end side. So machine learning
so is basically tensor or some other cluster things, for example, use it maybe or not.
Yes, you can say so, but as I said, yeah, it's just
it's done internally, right?
Yes, you don't see this whole stuff. For example, as I said, prediction IO, it's HBase, some database, and Apache Spark. So database used to store. Apache Spark get from cluster each information and computate this in memory and aggregate this into separate again storage database tables. And after this, you can just ask him about by this data, provide me some recommendation, for example. So it categorizes, for example, your products. You have a shop, some online shop. You push into this recommendation system like all your items. And it automatically recalculate all this stuff and store some predicted information already ready for you. And you just asking, okay, what about this product? Give me recommendation for customer. And it will provide for you number of predicted products, something like this.
Okay, thanks.
Have you had the chance to compare Apache Spark with TensorFlow and any feature comparison exists? Do you know which are input sources for TensorFlow comparing to available input sources for Apache Spark? Does it work, sir, with Hadoop also as Apache Spark?
TensorFlow?
Yes, TensorFlow.
As I know, Apache Spark is mostly not machine learning, it's general stuff. It's computational framework. So, yes, they have inside, you can add this, but by default, it's just how it was built. We have HBase, Hadoop, and Hadoop was not so fast because it worked in our hard drive. And guys decide, okay, let's create something like Hadoop for computational, but in memory. So Apache Spark also, it's work on clusters, but it makes computation in memory. And of course, begin like, okay, let's do machine learning and everything else because it can be splitted. And for TensorFlow, right now, it's what I can say, it's very young right now. It have very interesting stuff. For example, it have pre-built categorization for images. Right now, for example, if you they have special learning stuff, which you can consume to TensorFlow, and then just provide image and asking, what do you see on this image? And it will say, I see human, outdoor, anything else. So it's already have predefined stuff. For Spark, you can also find this, but it's really hard to do something like this. Also, what good with TensorFlow, it's by default little simpler maybe. And don't say this so good, but little simpler to begin testing with it on single machine because you just install pip install TensorFlow and begin testing how it works. Maybe bad stuff, like right now it's not version 1 point something, it's not stable. They awfully change API. And for example, I even tried to test some version TensorFlow, new version TensorFlow with TensorFlow RB gem, and it already not compiled, not working. Like it compiled, but not working. So right now, for example, Spark more mature, I said, and more general. So you can create not only machine learning on Spark, but everything else. For TensorFlow, it's just computational stuff, like to compute these all points, but provide information to it, and out of it, you should build itself. Like it's just framework, like Rails, everything else on you. Of course, I think Google will provide later something else to it, but right now, what do you see we have?
The question about technologies which can be used to explore machine learning in the product. Is there some amount of data which is good to manage in memory with libraries you showed, and some amount where only the cluster can be used, or maybe not amount of data and another characteristics?
So you mean like how much data should you have to begin working with cluster or just with single application? In most cases, if it's just a new product with so small amount of data, I mean like product launch several days and it collects some amount of data, you can do this already on single machine or on some like sidekick workers inside and even split this stuff. For example, in our example, we don't use, in my example with transactions, we don't use big cluster of machine learning because we begin with very simple idea like we will create categorizer for each customer separately. And each customer generates not big amount of data, and this category was not so big, like not a big amount of data. Also, if you use, for example, Bayesian filter, it's very small memory footprint. And then we grow this into general scope, like have local scope for customer and global scope, which learn from every customer. So in this case, it was not so hard because we serialize big amount of scope for all customers into databases and only ask in workers about this. For small scope, it always fit in memory. But if you have, for example, already mature product, they collect all information and decided to make some machine learning. So first of all, you made data management. You extract information which you decide will help for your machine learning, and then calculate how much information here. If you have at least, I think, several gigabytes, 10, 20 gigabytes of used memory, maybe in this case you need to create separate service to manage all this information. Because on one machine, it can handle this, but will work on hard drive, and it will be very slow for you. Like it will be very slow decision for your staff, several seconds, for example, to decide good for products. I think you will not so happy about this.
Anyone else? No? All right, that's it then.
Thank you.
Thank you.